As far back as I can remember, I have been totally in love with words. My earliest memories are of savoring language. I had a very intense relationship with words. And so I would sit and think about certain words all day long. And it wasn't just the sound of the word, it was also the shape, the spatial dimension, the color, the texture, the flavor. I had a multi-sensory experience of language and was infatuated from, I guess, the time I was exposed to language, from my first days on the planet. As I grew up, I realized that that's not how most people thought about language, and that a lot of the language you encounter day to day is sort of deadening. And I think it was upon realizing that that I began a search that resulted in my discovering poetry. And there aren't that many poets who seem to me to be at the highest level of managing the multisensory experience of language. But when I found Dylan Thomas, I knew that I had found a poet who was as good as you can ask a poet to be. It was very clear to me from the first few lines I looked at that he was thinking about language that way, experiencing language that way. From what little I know of it in Welsh, I have dabbled in Welsh and tried to read some of the poetry in Welsh, and also Welsh poetry in English has a tendency to kind of pop off erratically, sort of like popcorn, rather than to move with a processional grandeur the way that a lot of English poetry does. It's hotter and livelier. I don't think that Dylan Thomas was much on grand meanings. I think that he was big on moments, beginnings of meaning, flickerings into provisional meaning. And certainly, I think he experienced some sadness as he reflected on the drivers of that breaking down of meaning and structures of meaning in modern life. I mean, he was born the year that the Great War began. He lived through the Second World War. He saw all kinds of changes in Western society. He saw a lot of disturbing developments in modern life. He was alive during the time of the so-called death of God. I think religious faith was difficult for him. So I think his insistence on focusing on a beautiful, if idiosyncratically beautiful, type of moment is related to his sense that the early 20th century was not a good time for large, grand structures of meaning. I think he was mistrustful of that. He allows himself and encourages the reader to allow himself the pleasure of language, which is the vessel of meaning, because the meaning itself had been emptied out. Religions, governmental structures, every kind of source of meaning had been called into question, in some cases utterly emptied out of meaning. And so what you have left is the vessel of meaning, which is language itself. And Dylan Thomas says, let's make that as beautiful and pleasurable as possible. What else do we have? And that's an interesting response to what was going on in the early 20th century.
Hello, thank you all for coming out tonight, and thanks to Allen Public Library, Tom, Kevin, Michael, everybody for having me. It's a joy to be here to talk about one of my favorite poets. I do have to disagree a little bit with Tom. I do not come to you as a bona fide Dylan Thomas expert. I just come to you as a poet who loves Dylan Thomas and who was influenced by Dylan Thomas and would count him among the best poets of the English language. I haven't written. Well, you know, in the world of English language literary study, to be really called an expert on somebody, you need to have studied that devoted, you know, a whole portion of your life to that person and written a dissertation on that person. I haven't done any such thing with Dylan Thomas, but have been loving his poetry for a good long time. And I thought we should start tonight by getting Dylan Thomas's wonderful voice in our heads. So Kevin, if you could play that, and death shall have no dominion.
And death shall have no dominion. Dead men naked, they shall be one with the man in the wind and the west moon. When their bones are picked clean and the clean bones gone, they shall have stars at elbow and foot. Though they go mad, they shall be sane. Though they sink through the sea, they shall rise again. Though lovers be lost, love shall not, and death shall have no dominion. And death shall have no dominion. Under the windings of the sea, they lying long shall not die windily. Twisting on racks when sinews give way, strapped to a wheel, yet they shall not break. Faith in their hand shall snap in two, and the unicorn evils run them through. Split all ends up, they shan't crack, and death shall have no dominion. And death shall have no dominion. No more may gulls cry at their ears, or waves break loud on the seashores. Where blue a flower may flower no more, lift its head to the blows of the rain. Though they be mad and dead as nails, heads of the characters hammer through daisies. Break in the sun till the sun breaks down, and death shall have no dominion.
Amazing, isn't it? This guy drew huge crowds all over America, going around saying poems. As far back as I can remember, my greatest delight has been in words. My earliest memories are of savoring language. I remember lying in bed as a boy, overcome with gratitude for the bliss of words, realizing this was something no one could ever take away from me, realizing there was nothing I could buy or not buy, nothing I could be given or denied that would bring me so much pleasure as words. And this highest pleasure, amazingly, was automatic, unstruggled for. I couldn't believe what words made happen in my mind without my trying for these effects at all. Often when people talk about poetry or the glory of language in general, they talk about the sounds of words. But this has always seemed curious to me. Focusing only on sound robs words of their manifold magnificence. Sound is important, of course, but to me words have always been so much more than sound. A word I love, whether said into the air or only in the mind, activates a kind of multi-sensory experience, a Porphyro's banquet. Actually, more than that, a kind of non-representational sculpture I can hold and touch and eat, but that no matter how many times it is eaten, remains to be enjoyed again. The fantasy that one could miraculously have his cake and eat it too applies perfectly well to words. Words are blessed little prelapsarian Edens. I'm not talking about something that one arrives at by contemplation or close study. I'm talking about an intense, automatic event in the imagination that a word triggers. Days and days, whole days of my childhood, were blessedly spent delighting in words. I would become obsessed with a word like Swiss or tap or dot, and do little all day except to love it with my whole being. I especially loved small one-syllable words, and the fewer letters the better. The magical mini monosyllables like small flying saucers, logos becoming logos, were like whole vast planets and somehow tiny toys at the same time. They are paradoxes of hugeness and smallness, and nothing could be more blessed. When I was first learning words, I assumed everyone else was enjoying them as I was, and that whatever stultifying communicational imperatives might intrude, the main purpose of all speech must be to share in the pleasure of words. That is, for human beings to delight each other with the colors, shapes, spatial dimensions, textures, and tastes of syllables. When I was acquiring language and other people were talking to me, I experienced dazzlements of every kind in the brain. But I noticed that often people chose to combine words in ways that obscured their magical powers and properties. And this baffled me. Why not foreground the delight? Why hide it under a bushel? Being obsessed with words is the dominant memory of my childhood. I remember so many moments so vividly. In seventh grade grammar class, my teacher, Miss Lou Ann Burge, said the word play, and I thought I would die of delight. All I could think about for the rest of the day was the word play. I wanted to be that word. I wanted my whole life to be that word. I loved it so much, the way it tasted and looked and felt and sounded. In some ways, I was out of touch and in a kind of la-la land of my own imagination. But by this time in my life, I was starting to realize that maybe not everyone was going around loving language every minute of every day. I noticed that very few texts, if any, seemed to have been written for the primary purpose of getting words to be and do optimally beautiful things. Around this time, in maybe the eighth grade or so, I discovered Dylan Thomas, and his poetry changed my life. So much so that in a few years, when I was an exchange student in England and had enough money to make only one literary pilgrimage, I chose to go to Swansea, Wales, his hometown, and breathe the world he breathed. From the first few lines of Dylan Thomas' poetry that I ever read, it could not have been clearer that this man cared more about words' beauty than about any other of their properties. Words were beautiful in isolation, but combined, as they were in Thomas's work, they became more beautiful because their effects were synergistic. The words overlapped and changed each other, colors mixed, shapes combined and shaded into one another, tastes and textures interacted just so. I had never experienced anything so satisfying, and I felt I had found a friend. This account plays into the hands of Thomas's detractors, who are many, and who frequently dismiss his poetry as a mere adolescent indulgence. Every teenager's favorite poetic delight to be discarded in adulthood for poems of greater depth, complexity, and maturity. I have a feeling this is why Tom had trouble finding anybody to talk about Dylan Thomas. He's not particularly in vogue among academics. Thomas scholar John Wilkinson, speaking at the University of Chicago last October, highlighted this commonplace and rather stale, easy dismissal of Thomas. Kevin?
Whenever I mention I'm writing about Dylan Thomas, I hear a response which runs along the lines, "I used to love Dylan Thomas when I was young, but I haven't read him for years." It's commonplace that Dylan Thomas is an obscure poet with a popular readership, a technically disciplined poet who is also a byword for indiscipline and self-indulgence, and that his poems are loved by adolescents, a love frequently renounced in middle age. An example of such abjuring is the psychoanalyst Adam Phillips' shudderingly middle-aged revulsion from Thomas's, quote, "slapdash, slapstick, and apparently naively sophisticated Celtic fluency," renouncing the person Phillips was when he loved Thomas because Phillips remembers, or believes he remembers, Thomas, quote, "seemed to be the apotheosis of having a voice," unquote. To renounce your first love seems ungrateful. Behind Phillips's repudiation lies the charge that Thomas's writing is masturbatory, and not far behind either in the light of the adjectives slapdash, slapstick, otherwise so odd applied to a poet of stringent technique. Thomas remained stuck with his stick, while Phillips grew into the adult world, where intercourse and literature emerge as regulated practice out of the adolescent enjoyment of voice. Thomas is a writer who troubles us once we become literary, and Thomas's poetry may be popular in part because it disregards the bounds of propriety and the literary.
I love what he says there about how Thomas's poetry troubles us after we become literary. Wilkinson mentions that Thomas became a byword for indiscipline and self-indulgence. No one could describe the poet's roaring life more vividly than Thomas himself does, both repentantly and unrepentantly, in his masterful late poem entitled Lament.
When I was a windy boy in the bit and the black spit of the chapel fold, sighed the old ramrod dying of women. I tiptoed shy in the gooseberry wood. The rude owl cried like a telltale tit. I skipped in a blush as the big girls rolled ninepin down on the donkey's common. And on seesaw Sunday nights I wooed whoever I would with my wicked eyes. The whole of the moon I could love and leave all the green-leaved little weddings, wives in the coal-black bush and let them grieve. When I was a gusty man and a half and the black beast of the beetle's pews, sighed the old ramrod, dying of bitches. Not a boy and a bit in the wick-dipping moon and drunk as a new-dropped calf. I whistled all night in the twisted flues. Midwives grew in the midnight ditches and the sizzling beds of the town cried quick. Wherever I dove in a breast-high shoal, wherever I ramped in the clover quilts, whatsoever I did in the coal-black night, I left my quivering prints. When I was a man you could call a man, and the black cross of the holy house, sighed the old ramrod, dying of welcome. Brandy and ripe in my bright base prime, no spring-tailed Tom in the red-hot town, with every simmering woman his mouse, but a hillocky bull in the swelter of summer, come in his great good time to the sultry biding herds, I said. Oh, time enough when the blood creeps cold, and I lie down but to sleep in bed, for my sulking, skulking, coal-black soul. When I was a half of the man I was, and serve me right as the preachers warn, sighed the old ramrod, dying of downfall. No flailing calf or cat in a flame or hickory bull in milky grass, but a black sheep with a crumpled horn. At last the soul from its foul mousehole slunk pouting out when the limp time came, and I gave my soul a blind slashed eye, gristle and rind an aurora's life, and I shoved it into the coal-black sky to find a woman's soul for a wife. Now I am a man no more, no more, and a black reward for a roaring life, sighed the old ramrod, dying of strangers, tidy and cursed in my dove-cooed room, I lie down thin and hear the good bell's jaw. For, oh, my soul found a Sunday wife in the coal-black sky, and she bore angels, harpies around me out of her womb, chastity prays for me, piety sings, innocence sweetens my last black breath. Modesty hides my thighs in her wings, and all the deadly virtues plague my death.
Here, in his imagination, Thomas lies on his deathbed, and Lament was written not long before the poet, at the age of 38 or 39, would lie on his deathbed in reality. His widow, Catlin, as she pronounced it, C-A-I-T-L-I-N, Catlin, candidly recounted her husband's dying of downfall. This is the first Catlin video.
It was said that you were jealous of his success out there, Catlin.
Well, I probably was, I think. Now, thinking back, I wouldn't have admitted it then. But naturally, I would have preferred to have had the success myself. In fact, and I never went to his readings, which is very suspicious, you know, because, I mean, it is rather boring to listen to poetry reading, but I think there must be more to it than that. And he was an exceptionally good reader, there's no doubt. And I think what I hated most was all these young girls and students, you know, sort of pissing their pants in the audience, you know, when they're screaming at him as though he was a pop singer, or, you know, that's what I hate. Had he been more serious, or in the university, I didn't mind it. I wanted a serious, hard man. And he simply was just not that.
Can you remember much about that traumatic experience of his death when you went across there and collapsed pretty well?
Well, I can remember a certain amount. I can remember some pretty awful things about myself, you know. I can remember going there drunk in the airplane. And I managed to discover, I remember a farewell lunch they gave me in that lobster place. Tremendous lot of drink and so on. It was the last thing, that thinking of Dylan dying there. You know, no one, it was like just a celebrating party. And we were all sort of boozed up and they all, these old friends, you know, all kind of making merry and drinking, and they pushed me on the plane eventually, and I must have been very drunk. And on top of that, I found a place in the plane somewhere below, but there was a sort of little bar stuck onto the plane, which I didn't know existed, but I found it, and I drank a lot of whiskey on the plane. I must have, when I arrived in, I must have been really pretty dead drunk when I finally they conducted me to the hospital, and they kind of pushed me through because I had precedence, you know. And then I saw Dylan in the oxygen tent, and they left me there. And I didn't know, I really didn't know what to do at all. I, you know, being in that state and all. So I just sat on the bed and started to roll a cigarette, you know. And there was all the other people behind the glass partition gazing, you know, and presumably his other woman. I don't know if that was the Sarah one or the Liz one. I don't know if that's the same one, the one he was living with last anyway, and bringing in a lot of fans and all that. On the other side of that partition. And I couldn't think what I ought to do to perform to them, to do the right thing. The last thing I was thinking about was Dylan stuck under there, because he didn't seem to be there at all, if you know what I mean. As soon as I saw him, I knew he wasn't there, that he was gone, and that he would never come back. Oh, no, I couldn't regret marrying Dylan, because that's an experience in a lifetime, and he was a marvelous person. Let's face it. It's just that I didn't want to share him with anybody. But you can't expect of me to have someone who's made for everybody, all for myself.
Dylan the drunkard looms so large in our communal memory that he often overshadows Dylan the poet. In a 1978 essay titled "Dylan Thomas and Public Suicide," the famous American poet Donald Hall serves up a devastating account of Thomas's hideous behavior at a Harvard party in 1950, when the poet was 35 and only 3.5 years from his death. I don't know if it was clear to y'all from that video, but he basically drank himself to death. And he was just run ragged from his very strenuous reading schedule. He was on a reading tour in the United States. He died in New York City. Hall, Donald Hall, offers a balanced picture of Dylan's complex personality, showing that he could be irresistibly delightful as well as insufferable company. Hall admits that when he was in his early to mid-20s, he considered Thomas to be a great poet. But in 1978, when he's writing the essay, and when Hall was 50 years old, his judgment of Thomas's work was quite harsh. His arguments against Thomas are thin and wrong-headed, and I can't help thinking, given how smart Donald Hall is, that in the guise of faulting Thomas's way of writing, Hall was really faulting Thomas's way of living. There's a strangely moralistic flavor to many lambastings of Thomas's work, and this is certainly true of Hall's critique. I will read you the key portions here. Hall writes that in Dylan's handsome stanzas, the words watch themselves in the mirror, and the words love what they see. This, I take it, means that Hall finds Thomas's poetry narcissistic and self-indulgent. It is okay for Whitman, the American poet Walt Whitman, to sing of himself right down to admiring the smell of his armpits, but for Thomas to take and help his readers take unabashed delight in language, that is apparently out of bounds. Discussing a Thomas masterpiece, Hall writes, "When we cut through the glorious vegetation of Fern Hill, we see that the soil and rock underneath are commonplace. It was pleasant for a city child to come to the country on his summer vacation, then he grew up." That's Hall's summing up of the poem. This criticism is remarkably uncharitable and misleading. Yes, the story of Fern Hill is commonplace, much like that of Hall's celebrated Names of Horses, a poem I love, though not nearly so much as I love Fern Hill. Many great poems tell simple, common stories and express common human emotion. It is the way they tell these stories and express these emotions, or the ways, that makes the poems great. What does Hall want? A poem that advances superstring theory or triggers an exotic emotion never before experienced by human beings? Hall speaks of cutting through the glorious vegetation of Fern Hill, but who in his right mind would want to do that? I'll let you decide for yourselves what you'd like to do with Thomas's verbal vegetal brilliance. Here is Thomas reading Fern Hill.
"Now as I was young and easy under the apple boughs, about the lilting house, and happy as the grass was green, the night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb, golden in the heydays of his eyes. And honored among wagons I was prince of the apple towns, and once below a time I lordly had the trees and leaves trail with daisies and barley down the rivers of the windfall light. And as I was green and carefree, famous among the barns about the happy yard, and singing as the farm was home in the sun that is young once only, time let me play and be golden in the mercy of his means. And green and golden I was huntsman and herdsman, the calves sang to my horn, the foxes on the hills barked clear and cold, and the Sabbath rang slowly in the pebbles of the holy streams. All the sun long it was running, it was lovely, the hay fields high as the house, the tunes from the chimneys. It was air and playing, lovely and watery, and fire green as grass. And nightly under the simple stars, as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long I heard, blessed among stables, the night jars flying with the ricks, and the horses flashing into the dark. And then to awake, and the farm, like a wanderer white with the dew, come back, the cock on his shoulder. It was all shining, it was Adam and maiden, the sky gathered again, and the sun grew round that very day. So it must have been after the birth of the simple light in the first spinning place, The spellbound horses walking warm out of the whinnying green stable onto the fields of praise. And honored among foxes and pheasants by the gay house under the new-made clouds, and happy as the heart was long in the sun born over and over, I ran my heedless ways. My wishes raced through the house high hay, and nothing I cared at my sky-blue trades that time allows in all his tuneful turning, so few and such morning songs before the children green and golden follow him out of grace. Nothing I cared in the lamb-white days that time would take me up to the swallow-thronged loft by the shadow of my hand in the moon that is always rising, nor that riding to sleep I should hear him fly with the high fields and wake to the farm forever fled from the childless land. Oh, as I was young and easy in the mercy of his means, time held me green and dying, though I sang in my chains like the sea.
It's hard to do much better than that, in my opinion. Earlier, I mentioned that at some point in my childhood, I realized people weren't using words primarily to delight each other. I can't explain to you what a huge letdown this was for me, but before I realized the mundanity and deadness of some of the daily language we encounter, there was an excitement in learning words when I was absorbing the mystery of language. And there was a moment when I thought the world was a linguistic paradise whose dwellers were all constantly dreaming up new ways to delight each other with words. I thought that learning more about other people's everyday use of language would exclusively heighten and never undermine my pleasure. During this period of time, I would often make mistakes, thinking I was hearing something much more interesting than had actually been said. I think this is common with children. My good friend Johnny Wink, who teaches English at Washtenaw Baptist University, told me once that his little son Gene once spoke of mystics in the oven, triggering visions for Johnny of martyred seers, when really it was biscuits, not mystics. This is the type of thing that happens when you mishear song lyrics and cherish your mistaken version, only to learn later that the actual lyrics are far less interesting. My good buddy, the terrific poet Elijah Burrell, writes down his misapprehensions of song lyrics in a notebook and then uses them in his poems. After all, he made them up. In Sea of Love, a song by a band called The National, there's a line, "I see you're rushing now." Elijah heard, "I see you are Russian," as in from Russia now, which in the context of the song makes for a very interesting line. To my ear, Thomas's poetry reclaims these kinds of happy mishearings as the authoritative versions. In Fern Hill, as in many other Thomas poems, I sometimes catch banal formulations lurking threateningly just behind some of the most delightful phrases. For example, "windfall light," which is a striking, wonderful phrase, could easily have been the much less interesting "wonderful light." Elsewhere in the poem, we get "pebbles" and "holy" in the same line, suggesting to my auditory imagination, "holy Bible." But who wants a holy Bible in a poem when he could have a holy pebble instead? Simply because the holy pebble is new and interesting. We've heard of the holy Bible. Fern Hill is written in syllabics, meaning that the lines have set numbers of syllables. And John Wilkinson, whom we heard from earlier, points out that on the prosodic level, the chains Thomas sings in at the end of Fern Hill are the poem's formal constraints, the rules, if you will, of the form. You may recall that in the poem he said, "Time held me green and dying, though I sang in my chains like the sea." Wilkinson argues convincingly that any accusation that Thomas is a sloppy, undisciplined, or slapdash poet is simply unfounded and ridiculous. About Thomas's work habits, We know quite a lot, and Catelyn has something to say that should elucidate this matter further. Kevin.
In those early days then, Catelyn, when you were first married, what did he want to do with his life? Did he just want to write poetry?
That's the only thing he ever thought to do, yes. I thought the only thing he could do, he was, from the very start, he was had just the one idea, that the poems and the booze.
Poems and the booze?
Hmm.
In that order, was it then?
Yes, the poems definitely were more important, but I think he used the booze to kind of wipe out the poems, not to think about them when he wasn't writing them.
How did he write poetry? And was it easy for him or difficult?
No. It was terribly difficult, yes. He used to go into his little shed and scrape and scratch and mutter and mumble and intone and change. And he was frightfully slow, you know. In one whole long afternoon from about 2 to 7, he might have done just one line or taken out one word or put in one word.
In his poetry, he seems obsessed with his own childhood. He's always looking back.
Yes, he was. He was terribly sentimental about his childhood and his school days. And sometimes I think he never progressed from there. He was very romantic in that sense. I don't think he wanted to look forward.
When he did look forward, he, from the very start, seems to have been obsessed with the idea of an early death.
Yes, he was. Well, we neither of us wanted to get old and ugly. But he was the lucky one who didn't.
He was always convinced that he was going to die before middle age, was he?
Yes, he was. He had the ridiculous romantic idea, you know, of the poet starving in the garret and drinking himself. And he always built up this idea of being tubercular and, you know, being sick and hypochondriac, all that stuff, because his mother had pampered him so much as a little boy, and I think actually he was a lot tougher than he tried to make out, or he'd never have. His constitution was much stronger than he made out. He wanted to be pale and dying all the time, and actually his bones broke very easily. He kept falling down and breaking bones, you know, and all that helped the image he was trying to build up of the tubercular, consumptive, dying, pale poet, who was much more like David Gascoigne, actually. That was his image. And he wanted to be long and sickly and green and all that. But in point of fact, of course, he was square and small and not like the conventional idea of a poet at all.
Was he the same man in his own private life as he projected publicly?
No, he was rather off stage in the house. He just liked his warm slippers, you know, and his dish of titbits and pickled onions and sardines and anything with a lot of vinegar and cockles, all put on a plate which he'd stuff into his mouth when he was listening to the cricket scores. So, you know, he was just Mr. Everyman until he put on the act of being the poet, or until he wrote his poetry.
Put on the act of...
Well, he never liked to talk about his poems. but when he was in the pub, for instance, he was always telling funny stories, you know, but nothing to do with poetry. He didn't want to talk about it. And then when people came up and asked him, he would only, you know, answer perforce if he was made to talk about it, try to explain a poem or something like that. He didn't want to. He didn't want to be bothered with it, except when he was working on it.
Certain of Thomas's more charitable critics suggest that when he goes wrong, the problem is not that he's sloppy and undisciplined, but rather that his language is so compressed, so strange, so dense with meaning, that it is inscrutable. In effect, extremely charming mumbo-jumbo. But the late Southern poet James Dickey sees in Thomas's poems not mumbo-jumbo, but uncanny brilliance.
First of all, the main thing that Dylan Thomas has as a poet is that he is profoundly original-minded. He is original-minded. There's no fakery about it. Hart Crane is a very original poet, but he arrives at his originality by theory. Thomas arrives at his through the viscera, and because he's actually like that. he sees things in a way that's unique to him. He also has an ear which is as unique as his vision of things is, and when he puts them together, you get that tremendously powerful rolling South Welsh accent, and you get it coupled to a sort of a vision which is a compound of surrealism, a personal brand of surrealism, what else would you say? Sort of a song-like, ultra-rhythmical sort of a component. If you listen to Dylan Thomas, you can tell immediately what I mean. Let me just abstract a couple of lines from him, from a poem that's not one of his best. Open a pathway through the slow, sad sail. Throw wide to the wind the wings of the wandering boat, that my voyage may begin to the end of my wound. All this is a curious mixture of surrealism, Freudianism, nautical imagery, stuff about the sea and the wind and the search and navigation. All of this comes into a curious amalgam, but with the tremendous and highly individual thrust of Dylan Thomas's language, it seems inevitable. Anybody, the idea of someone opening a pathway out through a sail, who but him would have thought of that? And yet to him it's just natural to say it that way. It occurred to him, he puts it down that way, his personality is on it, and he goes on. He goes right ahead with it. He doesn't have any doubts.
Dickey is delighted by Thomas's eccentricity, whereas Hall seems to find it superficially enjoyable for a moment and then distracting and annoying later. Hall writes, "Dylan never put his poetry in service to anything outside himself except the muse. He served the muse. He wrote pure poetry. But what is pure poetry pure of? It is pure of thought, and pure of feeling, pure of vision, pure of enlarged consciousness. Its only emotion is love for words." The alcoholic, Lewis Hyde says, cannot go outside himself, lacks compassion and empathy, loses spirit by drowning under spirits. The immediate pivot here, from criticizing Thomas for being a limited poet to being a selfish alcoholic, is telling. What is Hall really finding fault with, Thomas or Thomas's work? I respect Hall as a poet and critic, but if he can read Thomas's work and find no evidence of thought, feeling, or vision, I can only say that I feel sorry for him. He is missing out on what Thomas's more appreciative readers find in abundance in his work and are deeply thankful for. Sometimes part of the formula for literary greatness is that a poet's particular gifts and predilections perfectly match the demands of his historical moment. And so we might ask the question, what does Dylan Thomas's fascination with and feel for words have to do with the historical moment he's writing in and his larger concerns, his thematic concerns? I do think that Thomas is a case of gifts matching historical moment. He was born the year the First World War began, and then lived through the Second. Predicting the poetry of our own moment, Thomas's vision is that of the inadequacy and falseness of visions, particularly totalizing visions, visions that try to bring the world under a rule. If Thomas's most obscure poems were being written and published for the first time today, they would still be seen as cutting edge, would probably be released by an avant-garde house like Fence, Nightboat, or Canarium down in Marfa, and would be even more challenging than most of those presses' other titles being released today. They would be challenging because, as Dickey says, the inventiveness of Thomas's language is unique to him. It is nothing we can understand as a function of recent theories or manifestos. And there's delight not just a Marxist or deconstructionist point in his cancellations of conventional meaning, his subversions of our expectations as to how a poem should behave. And contrary to critical consensus, or something approaching consensus sometimes, depending on the critical vogues of the moment, Thomas knows what he's doing. He, in fact, tells us what he's doing. He writes it right into his poems. Consider, for example, the poem, Was There a Time? I don't have a recording of Thomas reading this, so I'll read it. It's a very short poem. Was there a time? Was there a time when dancers with their fiddles in children's circuses could stay their troubles? There was a time they could cry over books, but time has set its maggot on their track. Under the arc of the sky, they are unsafe. What's never known is safest in this life. Under the sky signs, they who have no arms have cleanest hands, and as the heartless ghost alone's unhurt, so the blind man sees best. Now let's consider another Thomas poem, and we do have a video of an audio recording of him reading this. It's called Especially When the October Wind.
Especially when the October wind with frosty fingers punishes my hair. Caught by the crabbing sun, I walk on fire and cast a shadow crab upon the land. By the seaside, hearing the noise of birds, hearing the raven cough in winter sticks, my busy heart, who shudders as she talks, sheds the syllabic blood and drains her words. Shut to in a tower of words, I mark on the horizon, walking like the trees, the wordy shapes of women and the rows of the star-gestured children in the park. Some let me make you of the wild beeches, some of the oaken voices, from the roots of many a thorny shire tell you notes. Some let me make you of the water's speeches. Behind a pot of ferns, the wagging clock tells me the hour's word. The neural meaning flies on the shafted disc, declaims the morning, and tells the windy weather in the cock. Some let me make you of the meadow's signs. The signal grass that tells me all I know breaks with a wormy winter through the eye. Some let me tell you of the raven's sins. Especially when the October wind, some let me make you of autumnal spells, the spider-tongued and the loud hill of Wales, with fist of turnips punishes the land. Some let me make you of the heartless words. The heart is drained, that spelling in the scurry of chemic blood, warned of the coming fury. By the sea's side, hear the dark-voweled birds.
Especially when the October wind blows in, bringing the first deadly rumors of winter, Thomas wishes to give us the gift of beauty within non-meaning. Non-meaning is not exactly right, but a deliberate refusal of a clear panoramic view of things. In phrases like punishes the land and the coming fury, and in was there a time language like under the arc of the sky they are unsafe, and under the sky signs they that have no arms have cleanest hands, we might see evidence of a calamity larger than the end of the year. Thomas lived in a turbulent, war-torn time. The world was undergoing almost unimaginable cataclysm. His response is radical and before its time, before our time even, in a sense. He gives the reader heartless words, a meaning that's safe because it's never known. And he advocates being blind because the blind man sees best. What happens in Thomas's most challenging poems is that meanings begin beautifully to be born and then withdraw, giving way to the beautiful birth of a new meaning, which then withdraws and gives way. with a cumulative effect of delight by endless beginning, endless becoming. In altar-wise by owl light, we have a very difficult poem, and it's a longish poem. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I want to read you a couple of sections from it and then say something about it, because I think it's a model of some of his most difficult poetry. Death is all metaphors, shape in one history. The child that sucketh long is shooting up. The planet-ducted pelican of circles weans on an artery the gender strip. Child of the short spark in a shapeless country soon sets alight a long stick from the cradle. And then one other section. Now stamp the Lord's Prayer on a grain of rice, a Bible leaved of all the written woods stripped to this tree, a rocking alphabet, Genesis in the root, the scarecrow word, and one light's language in the book of trees. Doom on deniers at the wind-turned statement. Time's tune, my ladies, with the teats of music. The scaled seesaws fix in a naked sponge who sucks the bell-voiced atom out of magic. Time, milk, and magic from the world beginning. Time is the tune my ladies lend their heartbreak from bald pavilions and the house of bread. Time tracks the sound of shape on man and cloud, on rose and icicle, the ringing handprint. Thomas here not only performs this dodging of sustained meaning, but in a meta move acknowledges that he is doing all this and why, thereby achieving sneakily the larger meaning of non-meaning. An important implication of Thomas's more difficult poetry is that in a time of unbearable horror, an age when old gods are dying and old structures of meaning are crumbling, large visions are spurious, inadequate, deserving of our deepest skepticism, and maybe most important, psychologically dangerous. If Moses of Exodus can live only by not facing the face of God, Dylan Thomas's poetic persona can live only by not facing its absence. The speaker in Altarwise by Owlite cannot bring himself not to hear the scraping of Christ, even if the God seems to be no God at all, and to come from nowhere, bringing no eternally salvific tidings. Because the speaker can neither believe nor disbelieve, his thinking must be in brief bursts, hopeful but abortive, the beginning of something that can be neither sustained nor ignored. The poet is the child of the short spark in a shapeless country. That is, he is all flickers of faith with no discernible larger structure. Here Thomas prefigures language poetry. When I speak of larger structures, I mean of meaning, not of poetic form. Here Thomas prefigures language poetry and the post-avant poetry of our present moment. In confessing and responding to the failure of meaning in the early 20th century, Thomas was ahead of those, and we might count Donald Hall among this number, who demanded epiphanies based on defunct assumptions and sentimental myths. Thomas wrung our weathering changes, understood the brevity of a wick of words, embraced one light's language, knowing that the light was always changing, even within a single poem, and confessed in a wondrous moment of synesthesia that time tracks the sound of shape on man and cloud, on rose and icicle, the ringing handprint. The handprint fades, the icicle melts, and the rose wilts. But Thomas does something much weirder and more inventive than to confess the provisionality of meaning. Unlike T.S. Eliot and Ezra Pound and most of the so-called postmodern poets who followed them, Thomas allows himself and allows us to enjoy thoroughly that short spark that is all we have of meaning, the odd phrase, odd in both senses, the odd line, the beautiful mangled moment, even as the maggot eats away at everything. Hall concludes his essay by saying that Thomas never found the enlarging, enhancing wisdom that is poetry's real wickedness and real salvation. Since when is wisdom the defining element of poetry? Poems are made not of wisdoms, but of words. Hall wants Thomas's language to present a large meaning unassumingly. Thomas's language fires back and says, but in an age when meaning is breaking down, the words themselves, the vessels of meaning, if not the meaning itself, are what we have. Let us enjoy them. The words aren't dancing in the mirror. They are dancing for all of us while the ship goes down, because it's going down anyway, and the words know it. There is great generosity in this, and a radical urge toward enjoyment, even if the only thing left to enjoy is the flavor of our doom. Let me close by returning to Hall's risibly misapplied metaphor of vegetation. The poetry reader's job is not to hack away the glorious vegetation of a poem to find the rock of wisdom underneath it, some portable meaning, but rather to love the vegetation and love it with the whole being, the mind, the body, everything, the spirit. I do not say all great poems are wise, but any wisdom to be found in a poem, and there is certainly a wild sort of wisdom in Thomas, grows uniquely there, inseparable from its once in a universe vegetation, alive in the green fuse. Thank you.
Any questions, comments, or protests? Let me bring the microphone to you so we can get the question on tape. This is your time to protest, question, and think.
Can you tell me where he felt like he got his muse from? In other words, you know, we're like you said, we're not trying to dissect the man, but did he feel like he got it from all his pain and suffering in his life, or that he just that was a part of his creation?
It's hard to say. It is said that he was a sickly child, but he didn't have, from what I can tell, a particularly unhappy childhood. And really, the whole performance of the poet self came along after he had found his poetic voice. I think it can't be attributed to the suffering that went along with the alcoholic binges and the horrible hangovers. He did have horrible hangovers with 4 or 5 day headaches when the merest hint of light would crack his skull. So he wound up with plenty of grief, but during those days when he was miserable and alcoholic, he was writing like one poem a year or something like that. The last decade of his life, I think he wrote a poem a year or something like that. And he wrote the larger part of his corpus, what we think of as the Dylan Thomas canon when it comes to lyric poems, I think by the time he was 20. He was writing durable poems, poems that we still read and that are still widely anthologized, in his teens, you know, from the age of like 15 to 20. Amazing.
Questions?
And in fact, someone I read or saw a video of this said that early on, he was acting out drunkenness. A lot of times, this woman said, they'd be walking along in the street in the city, and he would be perfectly sober, but when his friends would come up, he would begin acting drunk.
Questions, comments?
Why did he turn to alcohol?
Well, he does seem to have been invested in, you know, the myth of the disheveled, drunken poet. And he, I think, genuinely enjoyed the pub. He liked that kind of companionship. He loved to hold forth and tell stories. you know, drink. He loved beer. He would just drink crazy amounts of beer, giant pints of beer, and he would sit and tell stories. And so Catlin and others, I think, would say that he wanted to be thought of that way. And it may be that it's just the opposite of what the gentleman in the back was wondering might be the case. It may be that the pain and suffering that went along with alcoholism didn't inspire the poems, but the pain and suffering of writing poems caused him to drink a lot. Because as Catlin pointed out, he would sit in his study from like 4 hours, you know, 4 hours a day, sometimes five, and he might, as she said, write two lines. And he corroborates this. Dylan Thomas said this on many occasions. He may write two lines. That was a good day. Some days it may be I took one word out or put one word in. You know, 4 or 5 hours. And then he would just go to the pub and get drunk. So I think maybe the strain of writing those kinds of poems drove him to drink. That's just speculation.
Any other? Okay, thanks. A couple questions. Where did he go to college, number one? And secondly, you didn't mention anything about his father. Was he an influence in his life? And thirdly, was there anything in his background that led him to go to become a poet?
Yeah, and I'm glad you asked about the father. The father was important. When Dylan Thomas was 4 years old, his dad would read Shakespeare to him. And his mother, who really pampered him, would say, "Don't read Shakespeare to him. He's 4 years old." And the dad said, he'll remember something. He'll get something from this. And this comes back to something I said in my lecture. There's something magical about hearing magical-sounding language that you don't understand. It's like when you're in a foreign country and you hear the people speaking a language you don't know. There's something magical about it. There's something alluring in the sound of language that you don't know the meanings of. And I think that Dylan Thomas's hearing Shakespeare when he was 4 years old might have helped him be okay with delighting in language that he couldn't make logical sense of. And that may have transferred into his writing, because he also allows himself to put things down on paper and allows himself to publish those things that don't really track logically. You can't make easy logical sense of a Dylan Thomas poem the way you can, you know, a Philip Larkin poem. So I think that's one way in which the father was a huge influence. And the father had a good library, and Dylan Thomas read a lot of classic English literature in his father's library. And he continues to love those things that he found early. Hardy, Yeats, I think Sidney was in that library. And he also liked the North Carolina writer Thomas Wolfe, which makes perfect sense to me. I think they have a lot in common, actually. So where did I go to college? I did undergrad at Wichita Baptist in Arkadelphia, Arkansas, which is only about, I think, 4 hours away. And I did my grad work at Ole Miss over in Oxford, Mississippi.
And did he go to college is what I was asking as well.
Oh, you were asking about Dylan Thomas.
Did he go, if he did go?
He did not. He attended grammar school and in Swansea. His dad wanted him to go to college, but he didn't want to do that. He thought he was ready to go, and he was already publishing. His first book was published very early, and he was writing poems that we still love and cherish today, so I guess maybe he knew best. Although one wonders what would have become of him if he had gone to the university, how that would have changed him.
Is there any evidence that he had contact or knowledge of the Dada movement? Because Dada dealt with words that didn't necessarily have to make sense, and they could be put together any way that the poet or artist wanted it to. Did he have any knowledge of that?
He did. He did. He never allowed himself to be annexed by the surrealist movement, but he was aware of it. My theory is surrealism was native to his imagination. I think Dickey is onto something when he talks about that. He says Dylan Thomas writes that way because he's really like that. I love the way Dickey says it. But Dickey may be a little naive in the way he describes the process, because we know that Dylan Thomas really, really struggled in the workroom to get those lines that are so scintillating. But I do think that Dylan Thomas's mind just moved in a way that we later can stand back and call surrealist. And I think that he may have been influenced in some way by the surrealist exhibitions that he attended. And I know that he went to one. But he had his own way of doing it. So his surrealism seems less programmatic to me than even a lot of the Lang Po that we've seen in this country in the last 30, 40 years, and some of the so-called post-avant poetry, which does seem to proceed from theories about how language works. I never get the sense that anything in Dylan Thomas is coming out of a theory. As Dickey, I think, wisely says, he arrives at his, what does he say? He says, Hart Crane is a very original poet, but he arrives at his originality through theory, whereas Thomas arrives at his through the viscera. And I think there's something to that.
Do you think our culture has caricatured him, or do you think the things that he's remembered for are a good spectrum of who he actually was?
Well, I do think that this version of him that his friends called Instant Dylan, the poet in performance at the pub, has overshadowed a lot of the other elements of his identity, and certainly overshadowed the poetry at times. But, you know, kind of combining your question with the last question, let me say this. Catlin said in one of those clips that she sometimes wondered whether he ever got past his childhood. And this is a charge that you see critics making, too. Oh, he's obsessed with childhood. He's so sentimental. He can't get past his childhood. But see, y'all know from talking to children that they often do things with language that could be characterized as surrealistic or experimental. And also, people, when they're sleep talking, will just spontaneously generate language that could pass for avant-garde poetry. Most people allow the apparatuses of censorship and personality editing that are clamped down on us as we grow up to kind of push them away from that kind of playfulness with language. Dylan Thomas never let that happen to him. And so there's a sense in which his attachment to childhood is a strength of his when it comes to writing poetry, because he stays in touch with that child mind, the native surrealism of the child's mind. And so I often think that criticism is coming out of envy or just a limitation on the part of the critic. So I think he has been misunderstood in that way as well. But yeah, all the drunkenness and bad behavior at parties has overshadowed his poetry sometimes. And the same thing, incidentally, has happened to James Dickey, who idolized Dylan Thomas and was rather his match when it comes to bad behavior at parties. Thank you all for coming.